The Savior of the world was fallen, His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon Him.
The storm was rolled away. His perfect. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Well, not only has he been raised from the dead, but he lives forevermore, never to die again.
Amen.
Not only that, he's here this morning.
Amen.
So why don't we sing to him? Why don't we pray to him? Why not even give our tithes and offerings for his honor? And why don't we listen to what he has to say? He's here this morning. Praise God.
Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the baptisms that we will get to witness and that you will shine through them in their everyday lives. I pray for the sermon that you will speak through Michael as he gives it. In your name I pray, amen.
You got something to be excited about today, so show your excitement. The Lord is risen. Here we go.
The greatest day.
Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you.
Thank you.
Well, life truly is worth the living because he lives. Amen?
Amen.
We're so excited that you're all here today. This is the greatest day in the calendar for Christians because we know this is what makes it all worthwhile. So we're excited that you're here this morning. I have just a couple of quick announcements for you. I'm not going to be going over everything in the bulletin, so do make sure you pick one up and that you read over it so that you don't miss anything. First of all, this coming weekend is April 21st through April 23rd, and that is our Faith Focus Weekend. We are having a special speaker come in. This is open to everyone who'd like to attend. It's going to be a really great time to uplift us in our faith. And there are sessions on Friday evening, Saturday morning, and then the Sunday morning service next week will be our last session for that. There is childcare provided for all those sessions, so please come to that and be encouraged in your faith. Also, next Sunday evening on the 23rd is our annual church conference. This is when we will elect our leadership for the coming year, the local board of administration, and our church officers. Everyone is welcome to come at 5:45, we're having a taco dinner, and then at 6:30, we're having our meeting. Everyone's welcome to come, but only members can vote, so just wanted to let you know that. Also, next Saturday, this coming Saturday, Jonathan and Allie, we're having a baby shower for them from 2 to 4 o'clock, so we invite you to come to that. It is a diaper and wipes shower, so pretty easy to pick out whatever you need to bring for that. Nikki could use some help. Nikki, can you wave your hand? She's sitting right there. If anybody can help her out, please see her after the service. And one last thing, we have one of our congregation members, Taya Baldwin. Where is she? Somewhere around. Oh, way in the back. Okay. She made, this week she made a lot of hot cross buns, which if you are not familiar with that, that's a very traditional Easter meal or dessert or something. But it's very traditional for Easter. It has a cross on it. And she made these for people who are not able to attend Easter services. And it's a great way for us to be able to give to people who are not hearing the gospel this Easter season. So please, on your way out, there are a whole lot of hot cross buns. Please pick a couple up and give them out to people that are having to work today. Maybe go to a gas station or the grocery store. Give them out to people and let them know that the Lord is risen and we have something to be really excited about. That would be a great way to minister to people who aren't able to come to church this morning. And we are so excited this morning about what we have to rejoice in. The Lord is here, and he's present, and we're ready to rejoice for him. We're going to go ahead and take the tithes and offerings, so if the ushers will come forward, and let's pray. Father God, we just come before you, and we want to lift you up on high. We want to praise your holy name, because you are victorious. You rose from the dead. You overcame death. We just want to glorify you this morning because you deserve all the glory and honor. And we want to give to you all that we can to honor you and to bless you. So, Father God, as we come before you this morning with our offering of worship and our offering of tithes and offerings, we pray that it would bless you and honor you and that you would use it to further your kingdom. We love you, Lord, this morning, and praise your name. Amen.
Celebrate.
Jesus, we worship you, for you are the Lord of life.
Lord Jesus, we worship you, for you are the Lord of life.
By your blood you have overcome death and redeemed your people.
By your blood you have overcome death and redeemed your people.
By your wounds you have healed us and made us new creations.
By your wounds you have healed us and made us new creations.
You reign victorious at the right hand of God and in the hearts of your people. We worship you, Lord Jesus, for you are the Lord of life.
We worship you, Lord Jesus, for you are the Lord of
Praise the Lord. He is alive. When I was a teenager, and that's been a few years ago, I attended a church in Alexandria, Virginia. And today I'm thinking about Brother Neil. You wouldn't know him, but you'll get to know him someday. We teenagers would sit and listen to the choir. It was about half the size, sing. And every Easter they sang, "He lives, he lives, he lives within my heart." You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. And when they got to the chorus, we would always listen intently to see how long Brother Neil would hold that last note out. And all the rest of the choir had run out of steam, and he was still hanging on to that note. And I think of that this morning. I'm sure he is in heaven celebrating. He has seen that he is alive and he is well. And we have so much to celebrate in knowing that Christ is alive. Let's bow our heads for prayer at this time. Heavenly Father, how we thank you and praise you for who you are. How we thank you that you loved us so much that you were willing to send your Son to die for our sins, to suffer for us. And because of that, you are alive and well. And Father, we have life and we have it more abundantly. We celebrate that this morning, Father. We pray that each one of us will take the Jesus Creed and agree to love the Lord with your God with all your heart, your soul, mind, and your neighbor as yourself. We pray as we reach out to our neighbors, our friends, our strangers, that we will share that love of Christ with all those we come in contact with, because we are so thankful that today we know you live because you live within our hearts. We give you praise and thanksgiving in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
I want to take a moment to mention this coming weekend that's been set aside for our focus on faith. The schedule and other important information is there in the bulletin, but there are some things about the weekend that are not printed, including, one, I want you to attend. I'm hoping you will. Two, our church needs to grow in its faith. We need spiritual maturity. Three, I'd be grateful if you could help with the cost. We'll take an offering Friday evening and you can give next Sunday. Be sure it's marked. And four, David Bartley, who's our guest, is a friend of mine, but that's not why I invited him. I have a lot of friends and I wouldn't ask them to lead a faith focus. I invited David because he fits this congregation. He's reserved and he's compassionate. He has the gift to take the core beliefs of the holiness movement, clarify them, and then make them applicable. For instance, Friday evening's focus will be Facebook meets Leviticus. Try to attend Friday evening, Saturday morning, and next Sunday morning. And child care is provided, if that's something you need. Someone asked me one day, what are the biggest struggles in being a pastor? And my answers were not the typical ones you hear. It wasn't people or finances, circumstances about the church building. It was a way of thinking. I said, there's two. One is biblical literalism. And by that I mean that tendency that we have to pick one verse out of the Bible and prove a whole point, even if it does speak against, is contrary to the rest of the Bible. We like to pull out a verse and let it support our points of view. The other, which is more serious, I think, is rationalism. The idea that knowledge is only by reason and experience, not by emotions or through religious revelation. Individualism that is now prominent in our culture, postmodern world, spurred that idea of rationalism. I remember when I was called to preach, took my first church in Thomasville, Georgia. I went down, thought I ought to buy a suit. I was in the big time now. It was a green polyester. Oh, it was ugly. But I found one I liked and I started to pay for it. And she said, aren't you the pastor at the Nazarene Church? I said, yes. She said, why don't you just take it and wear it a couple weeks? If you like it, then come back and pay for it. Try that now, see what happens. But the call was respected. My role was respected. After a while, it became, well, okay, if that's what you want to do. But that's just for you. That's just you and God. It has nothing to do with me. And now it's almost a liability sometimes to be a pastor. You're looked on with suspicion. And rationalism and individualism have spurred that movement along with many, many others. See, we're becoming more and more Greek in our thought. You know, in the New Testament where the Bible talks about the Jew and the Greek, or the Hebrew and the Greek. And the Hebrews, the Jews, they like signs. They want power. And the Greek, like rational thinking, reason, logic. Well, Jesus Christ didn't meet either one of those. The Son of God doesn't die on a cross. That's no power. And it doesn't make sense that Christ, the Son of God, would die. And so Jews and Greeks both often rejected the truth of Christ. But you see, my struggle has not just been with others. It's been my own struggle. For several years, I taught critical thinking to university freshmen. Critical thinking to 18-year-olds. So you know I believe in miracles. But I was critical thinking persona. I could analyze something to death and reason and think. And when it came to the Christian faith, I had to admit there were some things that didn't make sense. I was one step away from skepticism and abandoned it all. Then one day, I remembered that to know Christ is by faith. By faith. By faith. Most of my adult life, there was one thing I wanted to do, and that was to skydive, to parachute. Anybody ever skydived? Am I the only one? Well, I kept telling my wife that, and she said, if you ever do it, don't tell me you're doing it until you get back, because she'd worry. Well, I arranged it one Saturday morning. I got up and said, well, I've got a meeting, ha ha ha. And off I went, got in a little plane in southern Indiana, and we went up 2 miles. And jumped out. I did it in tandem. And the reason I did that, one, it didn't take as much training because I had a guy strapped on my back. Two, I could do the free fall. If you do it yourself, the chute opens as soon as you exit the plane. But if you do the free fall, the tandem, you get to free fall for a mile. And we were 2 miles up. Boy, I stood on the edge of that plane, and the guy behind me said, go ahead, now. But I did it. The initial sensation was incredible. That feeling of falling. And in seconds, you go from 0 to 120 miles an hour. Once you reach that maximum speed, that sense of falling isn't as strong. And I sort of, okay, this is all right. And I begin to notice things. But keep in mind, we're headed 120 miles an hour toward the ground. You free fall for about 40 seconds. And then the man pulls the chute. Now, I wasn't scared. I didn't think. But when that chute opened, I went, oh yeah, I'm going to live. So I must have had some doubts. And then it takes 4 or 5 minutes to finish the jump when the chute is open. And I could see everywhere, it seemed like, perspectives, different objects I'd not seen before. And so in my near skepticism, one day, I jumped. By faith, I decided to believe that Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead. That's it. I didn't dabble in it. I plunged into it. I gave it my all. I'll be honest with you, those first few days were a little scary, I guess. It's a funny feeling to just live by faith. But as it evened out, I began to sense freedom. I was free. Free from the bondage of mere morality or just religion. I was free to believe that Jesus Christ was alive. Then the chute opened. And then I began to become rational. And by that I mean, because Christ is alive, that I accept by faith, therefore, other things are true. You see, I don't believe the Bible's the Word of God because it says it is. That's sort of illogical, to make a self-claim. And I don't believe Christ has been raised from the dead because the Bible says so. Mm-mm. I believe because Christ has been raised from the dead, the Bible's true. You see the difference? See, Paul said, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, 1 Corinthians 15, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, what we're doing this morning is foolishness. Wouldn't this be absurd? Have that choir up there and the singing, all that. And if Christ had not been raised from the dead. And one said, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, nothing else matters. You see, one reason I took that plunge was I couldn't stand the despair not to. If Christ has not been raised from the dead, what's there to live for? What's there to believe in? Why stay with it? Nothing else matters if Christ has not been raised from the dead. Two weeks from today, I'm going to begin a series of sermons on how the followers of Christ after the resurrection were able to take that plunge. You know, it's not easy to believe someone's been raised from the dead, especially if you saw him die and you helped bury him. If someone came along and said he's alive, you'd go, yeah. But little by little, and finally they took the plunge and accepted by faith. And the difference it made in their lives is incredible. And we'll look at those. Our favorite person in the Bible, other than Christ, has to be Peter. He's one of us, isn't he? We can relate to him. Bless his heart, as they say in the South. Bless his heart. The day before Christ died, Peter and the other disciples were arguing over who's the greatest. Can you imagine? Here's Peter. I think I'm number one in this show. Thank you. James and John, I don't know. Maybe number two or three, but even one of their mothers got into it. Who's the greatest? Oh, yeah, the same Peter that when they came to arrest Jesus, took out his sword and started swinging it. You know what he did? He cut off the ear of a servant. A servant who wasn't even armed. A servant who wasn't there. A guy that was just a bystander. He cuts his ear off. That's how good of a swordsman Peter was. Duh. And then just hours later, Jesus who? I don't know the man. Jesus, never heard of him. Oh, I'm not one of his disciples. You see, many of us would let that destroy us. We let lesser things destroy us. But Peter took the plunge. And 40 days later, 50 days later, here's what he's doing. He's standing in front of thousands of people who've gathered in Jerusalem and saying this. This is not about battles and fighting. This is not about swords. The power that we have, he said, has come from the Holy Spirit. Christ is our strength, not our weapons. He goes on to say, when you leave this town, because many of them from other cities, many of you will go by the tomb of David. It was sort of a sightseeing side trip. And you'll pay homage to him. And he's buried there. And that's the right thing to do. But don't waste your time going by the tomb where Jesus was buried. Because it's empty. There's nothing to see. Now, I would have thought, if I were there, I would have been thinking, hey, Peter, did you forget about the sword thing? How you botched that? Hey, how quickly we forget about denying Jesus. Remember that, Peter? But see, he'd taken the plunge. Yes, it's true, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, nothing else matters. But it's also true that if Christ has been raised from the dead, nothing else matters. Our failures, our shortcomings, our past. When you take the plunge, you become a new person in Christ. And they don't matter anymore. You now live the life of the Spirit, of the resurrected life. Okay, there's some skeptics here this morning. You're a reasonable person, and you don't have to be irrational to be a Christian. But I want to challenge you. You ready? Jump. Don't jump into this truth and that truth. Don't worry about that now. Just jump into the great truth and believe that Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead. It'll change your life. It'll change your life. Paul said that when we baptize each other, it's somehow we are reliving the death and resurrection of Christ. When we go under the water, it's like being buried with him. You're in the tomb. But when you're raised from the water, it's like being raised as Christ was resurrected to live a new life. And what a day to be baptized. Today, there are two of our members that have asked to be baptized. And we're going to close this service by celebrating their obedience. I'd like for them to come. I'd like to introduce them to you. This is Julie. Most of you know her, Julie Freikart. And this is Dylan, and most people know you, Dylan. But this past January, you took a plunge, in a sense. You had a life-changing experience with the risen Lord, and he seemed to make a total claim to you. Right? And you said yes. But when you did, it realigned your priorities. You saw things differently after that. Is that right? And then you felt the great need to witness to the church, to God and yourself, you're a new person in Christ. It's a joy to baptize you this morning. Thank you. Dylan, about a month ago, Ann Staley mentioned to Jerry Reed, the youth leader, that she would like to say something to the teens on a Wednesday night. And Ann told her story. And at the end of the story, she said, if any of you would like to come to Christ, you pray this prayer. And she led this prayer. You went up to her afterwards. You were crying. And you said you'd given your life to Christ. Right? And then a couple weeks later, you and your mother came to me and you wanted to be baptized. I'm so proud of you. Thank you for doing what's right. And after discussing it with her, I believe that you understand enough. She doesn't understand at all, but neither do you. Right? I don't. There's always the mystery element of faith. And it's a joy to baptize you this morning. God bless you. You too can go prepare to be baptized now. Follow her. Don't act like her, just follow her. We're going to sing, and at the end of the song, I would like family members that would like to observe this more closely to stand near the baptistry. And we've got a photographer lined up that will take pictures for the family or anybody else that wants, and she'll be behind that wall. So we need the family of the person being baptized on the left. And Julie will be first. So if you're wanting to get a closer observance of Julie's baptism, you will stand to the left over toward the cross, and you'll see the photographer. Then when it's Dylan's turn, if the families would switch, I'd appreciate that. And the families that's not observing would be over to the right. And celebrate when these people are baptized. It's good news. Christ is alive. Let's sing together.
I'd like to invite you to stand with us as we sing.
anyone want to join for you to come? Stand right here if you would. Come closer if you would to the baggage room so that the photographer can see you. Gotcha. Julie, by being baptized today, do you witness that Christ is the Lord of your life?
Yes.
You believe in his death and resurrection?
Yes.
And you believe that you know him personally?
Yes.
You've committed your life to him?
Yes.
Well, it's a joy this morning to baptize you. Julie, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Family, if they would like to come. You can stand where your photographer can see you there. Dylan, by being baptized today, do you witness that Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life?
Yes.
You believe that he who was crucified as dead has been raised from the dead?
Yes.
And you committed your life to him?
Yes.
Praise God. And it is with joy this morning that I baptize you. And I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Risen.
He's risen.
He's risen indeed. Amen. Isn't that awesome? Let's give those that were baptized a hand again. God is so good. Let's close the service in prayer. Father, thank you so much for the freedom and life that we have because of your Son's sacrifice. God, we praise you. We praise you for what you have done. That you love us so much that you sent your Son so that we could have eternal life, life with you, and life abundantly. God, you are so good. Hallelujah. In your name I do pray. Amen. You are dismissed.